We are talking about Four Noble Truths, right? So, to understand the Four Noble Truths, not just intellectually, but experientially, we have to practice and understand a few things. And the first is we called recognition. We sense that something is wrong, but we are not able to say exactly what it is. We must, first of all, recognize that we are suffering. Recognize we are suffering. Our suffering needs to be recognized. Recognizing our suffering is like the work of a doctor diagnosing an illness. The doctor say, if I press here, does it hurt? And then sometimes we say, yes, it's a hurt. This hurt, and you know, and we say, this is my suffering. The doctor shows you, right? It's press here, and then, wow, that's painful. That's my suffering. Then not that enough, right? And then doctors say, "Well, don't worry, I will take care of that. I'm here for you for that, you know. I will take care of your illness. Don't worry. But in order to take care of this suffering, then you have to understand. You have to recognize." So that's why the first we called recognition. What recognize? The suffering. And the second we called encouragement. After recognize our suffering, we take time to look deeply into it in order to understand its true nature. When I say true nature, this true nature means, which means its cause. That's true nature. In order to understand, in order to fix it, we have to understand the true nature, which is the causes. Encouragement. And then also there is a we called realization, right? The doctor tells us the name and all the characteristic of our illnesses. Your illness is this and this and this. Why? Because of this, you know, the doctor tells you, right? And then we will know what kind of medicine we need. And similarly, we can call our suffering by its sort of a specific name and recognize all of its characteristics, and then we will know how to end of our suffering. So the Buddha said that when something has come to be, we have to recognize its presence and look deeply into its nature. When we look deeply, we will discover the nature and its causes. So, recognition, encouragement, realization, very important in order to understand the truth, the suffering, the truth of suffering. So, we already talked about the first characteristic of the truth of suffering, right? You understand now? Now, the second characteristic of is what? Impermanent. You can see here. The four characteristics, right? Truth of suffering here. Truth of suffering. And then there, this line, the middle, the center lines, goes down. The characteristics. So the truth of suffering characteristics are suffering, impermanence, emptiness, and selflessness. So we already talk about suffering now. That's done. No more. Then the second characteristic is impermanence. So here the impermanence includes the fundamental impermanence of birth and death, right? And the also formation and destruction of the universe, as well as the change of the seasons and so on. So everything we say impermanence. It also includes the sort of subtle impermanence, which is the fact that all conditioned things constantly changing, moment by moment, and never sort of remains unchanging. So impermanence. People tend to think that everything is permanent. What is the difference between impermanence and permanent? So people think that it's permanent, right? Permanent. When they think permanent, then what happened? Then they have attachment to it. If we understand impermanence, then we know that everything is changing all the time, moment by moment, second by second, day by day. Then we automatically start thinking about needing and wanting more time to practice and study. For example, when you have good food, nice clothes, or everything, and for short time you feel really nice, wonderful. Not only you enjoy a feeling of satisfaction, but when you show your things to others, they also, you know, share in it too. But then one day passes, 2 days passes, and 1 month passes, and then it will get worse and worse. Then it gives sort of you, causes you sort of frustration. Can I say frustration? Yeah, frustration. So that is the nature of things, they change. That is the nature of things, you know, that's the nature of things. And if you look carefully, everything beautiful and good, everything that we considered desirable, bring us suffering in the end. That's why we sometimes, really we are happy, sometimes unhappy. This is because everything is impermanence. They are not same all the time. And when they change, either makes us happy or unhappy, right? We can't do anything about that. That's why what is the characteristic of this world is suffering. Because everything is like this, changing. And the very end, that's why, according to Buddhism, we say this world, the characteristic of this world is suffering. for the beginner, you are happy, wonderful, you have everything, but end difficult because of suffering. That's why we have to escape this world, the samsara. That's why we need freedom, total freedom, liberation. So we need to understand our life, and we need to know that what is the relationship between the idea of impermanence and our life. So we need to understand the precious, right? Precious of the human life. Very important. In Tibet, sometimes there we call outer preliminaries, precious human life. They make you practice like 4 months, 1 month practice on precious human life, 1 month practice on impermanence, 1 month practice that you practice about karma and cause, you know, 1 month practice about liberation, the benefits of liberation and defects of samsara. So we need to understand that our precious human life, this is wonderful life. We have to understand that. We have to recognize that, you know. And we need to think about how sort of that precious human life could end at any time, right? We have to know that. This means that we need to use our life in a good way as much as we can while we have the opportunity. That's so important. This opportunity is very sort of uncertain. We never know what's going to happen. So when we have this good opportunity, we have to use it. Otherwise, we are sure to die, right? Some point, but it's really unknowing when we will die. That's the problem. That's the problem. And when it comes out to the time to die, then there is absolutely nothing that can help us. So whenever there is a birth, then death is only nature consequence, you know. That's just we are, you know. And also we are sure we are die. But we are not sure when. That's the big question, right? When? We are not sure. If you don't have wisdom mind, then we don't know when we are sure, when we are die. And sometimes, you know, people might think that we are young. We are young. But according to Buddhism, this is no guarantee, you know, that you are not die. If you say, I'm not going to die because I'm young, not good reason. We might think that everything is all right, you know, that we have food, we have clothes, we have shelter, and so on and so forth. That also no guarantee against you or not die. We might also think that we are in good health. But how can this make us confident that we will not die? There are so many obstacles in our life that we are forcing, you know. So we not, you know, it gets closer and closer. Sort of from the moment we are born, right? The life can only get shorter. It never gets longer. Every moment, every day, every minute, every, you know, all the time. Our life is shorter and shorter and shorter like that. It's not one day happened, right? It's just also changing. Every moment, just we are just shorter, shorter, shorter. Our life is shorter. And so why we need to know this? Because right now we have a good opportunity and we have a precious human life. We have to use this good way. Because we don't know. We don't know what happened in the future. So as long as we have a good opportunity, we have to use it good way. Otherwise, we don't know. Otherwise, we don't know what happened, right? That's why we have to know our life. You have a good life or you have a bad life. If you have a bad life, you have to change into good life. If you have a good life, you have to use it as much as you can. That's the point, you know. Otherwise, we sort of still spend all of our time sort of hoping and worrying about our future, you know, always worried our future as if we are going to live forever, you know. Okay, if I stay, maybe I will die like 100 years. Do I have enough money? Or like that kind of. We are just calculating, you know, how much money I have in my bank. And when we meditate, we are just thinking that. Just make plain our future. I mean, it's good. It's good, but it also makes you really worry. So I think, okay, that's just fine. Right now I have this much. I have enough everything. So I'm very happy with this. I'm very enjoy with this. In the future, I can do something. You know, I can do something. It's no problem, no worry. In the future, I have never ever planned future in my life. Something is just coming. You know, it's amazing. It's just amazing. You know, so I have to go back to Tibet in this month. Well, I say that in my mind, but unsure if this is this is not really. I always tell my Sangha, I can't do plan in my future because I don't know. It comes.
Still try to nail him down.
You know. But right now, I'm better. The first time, really, I don't want to make plan in the future. And my translator told me, hey, Khenpo, you really have to plan, make a plan in America. These people really have to make plan, otherwise nothing happen. Well. But now I understand. We have this schedule, okay. I follow my schedule. That's kind of plan, you know. But without worry, you know. You can make plan without worry. Some of your plans are really worry, you know. Worry and stress plan. That's plan not good. Plan is good, but without worry, without stress plan is good. And without worry, never plan that in the future. Because it's not good for your life, you know. It makes you really unhappy. We don't want unhappy. We are really sick for, you know, happiness. But we don't understand how to find happiness. Because, I have this plan, this makes me happy in the future. But not, because it's make you suffering, because you worry too much, you are thinking too much. Some people really can't go sleep, just thinking. One person, life is very easy to take care of one person. No problem, it's just very easy. It's one person, it's very easy. So according to this country, you have a big family, but all the people have a responsibility. They take care of their life. Why you worry your children? Children grow up and they take care of their life. So really you worry about just one person. Not people say, I worry about my family, but really you worry yourself. You know, so the one person, it's easy to take care of life, you know, one person. So that's why I think it's very important, you know, right? Western people don't like to think about impermanence, but I think that's not a good idea, because impermanence is part of our life. We have to understand our life. So suffering, impermanence, happiness, all this are part of our life. So if you really want to take good care of your life, you have to think of this. These are kind of really important. And also, not only your life, everything else, everything is impermanent. So everything is, we call it samsara, right? Samsara is impermanent. It's impermanent. So I don't know how many of you understand what the meaning of samsara is, you know, but it means that which causes us to not to recognize the true nature of our mind. Samsara is the Sanskrit, right? Sanskrit term for sort of a wheel. Just as a wheel goes around and around and around, there is no beginning, no end. No end. Something is, when you died, your body becomes something. Understand this? When I say samsara has no beginning, no end, that means when you die, your body is become something. And something is come, you know, it causes another things, right? You, I don't know, whatever you do, or cremate or something, you know, and then this goes earth and maybe causes flowers, maybe trees, or maybe some water, something. It's never ended. It's something happening the next. And that like that. It goes around and around. And according to Buddhism, that we believe that future life, that means your bodies become something else, but your mind also goes around, your consciousness. So that's why we say the samsara is like a wheel. It goes around, around. So samsara means that. So what really happens in samsara is, if we do not realize our mind, then we will naturally harm others, right? Harm others, and we actually run away from the true cause of happiness. If we don't understand the true nature of samsara, we are run away from our happiness, and we are always harm others. That makes us really suffer, big problem. So as long as we are in samsara, then everything changes moment by moment. So this is actually called the, what do you call it? Suffering of change, right? Suffering of change. But if we have a sort of happy life and good life, then doesn't matter when we will die, right? Die. There is a birth, there is a death. So if we have a happy life, good life, don't worry, you know, to die. That's nature. No problem. So if we understand impermanence, then we will know that everything is changing all the time. Then we, what, automatically will think about our life. And we will know how to take care of our, life. So what is the point to think about impermanence? If you think about impermanence, so automatically you think about your life. Definitely, you think about your life. And then if you have a not good life, you have to change. Because you can, because it's impermanent. And if you have a good life, then you can use it as much as you can. So that's the point. That's the point to think about impermanence. So that's, I think, permanent and impermanent. Permanent means never change. Never changing, all the time same, but that's, we can't find that kind of things in this world. So now that's, now we talk about third and fourth characteristic of suffering. I'm going to teach this two together, okay? So we're done suffering and impermanence, that's the characteristics of suffering, and the selflessness and emptiness, right? So there, now the first selflessness, there are two types of selflessness. These are the selflessness of self and selflessness of phenomena. So whenever we search and investigate, either inside or outside of our own body, there is nothing that we can find self. I mean, in ultimately, okay? The same is true with all phenomena. When we investigate, we find it has no defining characteristics in ultimately. Each of has a nature and spontaneous feeling of I, right? I. This is what experience happiness and unhappiness. I'm happy. I'm suffering. I. So they are very... many different points of views from a variety of philosophies throughout time that considered about the why that the consider of the way that the I existence. Many different ways. I think like 360 schools, different view about self. Right? But according to Buddhism, recognize when we investigate the nature of self has no true existence or permanent outside the mental and physical aggregates. Buddha went to Bodhicitta and he discovered through his sort of deep meditation that what we call I or self is actually not exist at all, and ultimately, you understand about Buddhism, there are two truths, relative truth and ultimate truth. So relatively, yes, we are here, I am there, I'm talking, you are listening, right? That's relative truth. But not only one truth. We have two truths, ultimate truth. And ultimately, no. So, if we want to understand ultimate level, the truth, then we have to change our view and investigate deeply what we call self or I is combination of every sort of ever-changing physical and mental forces or energies, which are divided up into five aggregates, okay? The five aggregates are are like a building. It's a combination of things. This house, how you say this house? Relatively, yes, this house. Ultimately, where is this house? The window is not house. The wood is not house, like that. You investigate, become sort of empty. You can't find anything. Where is the house? Where is me? This is my head, it's not me, not I. This is my hand, not I. Where is it? But relatively, yes, you can see me, right? It works. That's how we are. But ultimately, no. That's why we have emptiness. That's why I'm talking about the selflessness of self and emptiness. When you investigate yourself, you will find emptiness. People think that I is really permanent and it exists. But how? They can't give you the reason. They can't say, yes, I believe I, me, self is permanent. People think that, that's all. Then you ask more. They can't give you why permanent, where. Okay. So this actually I self is, according to Buddhist point of view, the five aggregates, the combination of five aggregates, which are form, feeling, perception, mental formation, and consciousness. In Heart Sutra, we have that, right? Five aggregates. I will explain you this later. It's very important to know the five aggregates. That's the person. When you say this person, it's a combination of these five aggregates. So it is that the aggregates determine the nature of what we call me and I. Because these aggregates have to come together due to karmic forces. The karmic force, the appearance has arise. The aggregates are the sort of condition that has made the sort of appearance possible. Relatively. Due to the nature of this appearance, a sense of self or me or I has arise, right? Or I has arisen. So this idea of I gives rise to self-interest. In ultimate state, it is the state free from any form of negativity. This is the true nature of all beings. This is the reality. This is what we have sort of behind the illusion of I that arises due to the manifestation of the aggregates. If you don't understand the I or self is combination of these five aggregates, then very difficult, because the selfish, right? Selfish comes from I, arises from I or self. Selfish is not good. Good, not good for you, not good for others. Selfish is really bad.
What were the five aggregates again?
I told you, I will explain you later.
Okay.
Yes, it's very important to understand five aggregates. So that's why this our body, this is really combination of the five aggregates. And then you investigate deeply these five aggregates, you will find emptiness. So the second and the third and fourth characteristic of suffering is really they're talking about emptiness. In order to understand emptiness, there are many ways, but the point of view, the Mahayana point of view, you have to investigate first yourself and then others. I mean, where I, where me, self, where? They're not talking about ultimate, the ordinary people's view, right? This time they talk about the ultimate truth. So you cannot find I. Maybe you should investigate where. But some people are scared. They think they will lose their sort of essence, you know. But that's why Buddha taught two paths, the lesser vehicle and great vehicle. So lesser vehicle, these people, that's why the lesser vehicle, this kind of student, they really don't understand emptiness. Like it's difficult for them because they're afraid, you know. If you say, you know. But if you're a Mahayana practitioner, then easy to understand emptiness through investigate self. I would like to practice meditation. Do you want practice the three channels more, or you want to practice a little bit different? Because last section we didn't have lots of time to practice on the three channels.
Different?
Yes. All right. Why you think different?
Well, because I feel like we have that tool and can go home and work on that ourselves, but we have you for a short period of time, so teach us something.
I think that's really good. I know you will say that. All right, so that means you understand how to practice on three channels, right? Okay. Right, you have lots of time, so this is really... I don't know in this area how many groups here, how many teachers will come and teach you, but maybe not many. So it's kind of very important to understand how to meditate and on different instructions, right? So I have, I just told you, I'm not achieved. Final destination, but I have a very good pit instructions from my teachers, my lineage. Lineage is, according to Buddhism, so important. Lineage means I learning these teachings from my teacher. My teacher learning these teachings from his teacher, like that. Go back and just back way to Buddha. So. Actually, this teachings comes from Buddha, so never broke teachings, Buddha's teachings, because these teachers, right? Buddha's student has a student. The student has a student like that. That's what ancestry, or you call lineage, right? So that's why lineage is very important. So these teachings actually comes from Buddha, directly go back to Buddha. So it's important. So now, meditation, right? Meditation, you understand, meditation is in Tibet, gom. We call it gom. This means to become accustomed or doing something. During the meditation, the mind does not fall under the sort of influence of thoughts, gom, or mental sort of negativity. So meditation is very similar to familiarization meditation, because one continues meditating, even if it is sometimes doesn't go well, the obstacles and sort of problems very often arise, but one continues and habituate oneself to sort of meditating until it becomes easy and really natural. So now I give you a very good one. This is from my root teacher. Good instructions. So in this meditation, you focus on a syllable. We have done this many times, right? A syllable, and it's also combined with your breath, with your breathing, you know. So you should start visualizing the syllable in front of you, or you can visualize the syllable tip of your nose or your third eye, doesn't matter. So you have to visualize a syllable, and then also with your breath, as you naturally breathe out, visualize this a syllable, right? You can also visualize many different things. You can visualize a syllable, you can visualize feather, you can visualize a spear of light, whatever is comfortable, it's, you know. And then you visualize when you breathe out, for instance, if you visualize a syllable, when you breathe out, moving away from you and getting bigger and bigger, this, from your nose, right? Understand? Getting bigger and bigger, and expanding into the sort of distance. And then before you breathe in, little bit pause, and rest for just a second, focusing on your on this syllable. As you begin to breathe naturally in, and then visualize this syllable coming back towards your sort of nose and getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So again, once you have completed your breath, and then you pause for a second and focus on the syllable, that's on your nose or third eye, whatever, and then do again, like breathe out, and it's moving away from your nose, and then getting bigger and bigger, and then pause and a little bit focus on that. This, so alternately out, in, out, in, actually out, pause, in, pause, out, in, pause. Understand? You can visualize a syllable. Also, you can visualize that white a syllable, blue a syllable, whatever. Or you can visualize a feather, white, black, whatever. Or you can visualize very white spear of light away, moving from your nose, and then getting bigger and focus on that. Understand? Okay. Good. Let's do that 10 minutes, and then we'll take a break because you are looks like Philip. I shouldn't you have a lunch.
Yeah. It's the weather, I think.
Weather and lunch. Wow. All right. Wake up. All right. very nice. Where is the schedule? Okay. 2:55. Okay, 10 minutes. Let's do 10 minutes. Okay. If you're really sleepy, you should keep your eyes open. Mm-hmm. If you keep your eyes closed, then if you're not, that's okay. So just relax, okay? 1 second, bring your mind back. There is a very nice quote from a good teacher. He said, make sure you are on cushion or chair. Make sure your mind in your body, bring your back in body. Make sure the peacefulness in your mind. Then you can make very good meditation. You can do very nice meditate. If you have did these three conditions, then you can do it. You can meditate very well. So bring your mind back and don't follow your thoughts. Don't worry about your thoughts. Just naturally let them come, go. But more important is focus on your the visualize. Oh, okay, so that's very important. Now I'm going to explain you a little bit about five aggregates. Okay, five aggregates. Oh, ho, ho. Form, sensation, perception, formation, and consciousness. Five aggregates. Form, feeling or sensation, same, right? Somebody's there. And then perception, formation, and consciousness. All right. So the first is form. The aggregate of form communicates to what we call material or physical factors, right? And it includes our own bodies. Understand? And material object as well. Especially the aggregates of form includes the five physical organs, right? Eyes, ear, nose, tongue, body, right? And also corresponding physical object of the sense organs like sight, sound, smell, taste, and all this. It also includes not only our own bodies, but also the material object that surrounded us, right? The earth, the ocean, the tree, the house, the building, all so forth, you know? The form means like that, so many things. That's the first aggregate. And the aggregates of sensation or feeling is three kinds, right? We understand that very well. Pleasant, unpleasant, and indifferent. What is the pleasant, unpleasant, then what?
Neutral.
Neutral, yeah. Yep. Feeling has a three. When an object is experienced, that experience takes on one of these emotional characters, right? The character of pleasure or the character of, you know, displeasure or the character of, you know, indifference. So the aggregates of feeling or sensation, that's the second. There are three kind of characteristics. And then the aggregates of perception, This is an aggregate which sort of many people find difficult to understand. When we talk about perception, we have in mind, right, activity of sort of recognition or identification. So this aggregate perceives or recognizes both physical and mental objects through its contact with the sense. When we become aware or conscious of an object or idea, our perception recognizes its distinctions from the other objects or ideas. So this sort of distinction makes us familiar with the object or idea when we sense it in the future. Perception, that's the perception. And then the aggregates of mental formation or thoughts process, that's I think same, mental formation or thoughts, described as a conditioned respond to the object of experience. These aggregates include all mental factors except feeling and perception, which are two of the possible 52 mental factors noted in Buddhism. 52. I don't want to go into detail. I learned this so much, you know, I'm kind of done. Okay, so in short, mental formation you understand what I'm saying, the mental formation.
Mental formation.
Mental formation. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Perception?
Is that what you're talking about? We're using our mental formation?
Mental formation and perception are different, right?
So I think first you perceive and then you form concept.
Exactly, yes.
Perception.
Right, that's okay. And then the last is consciousness, the aggregates, the last consciousness. This is the most important of aggregates, right? Because without consciousness, there can be no mental sort of factors. They are sort of interrelated or interdependent. So the mind and its faculty is not something physical. It is concerned with thoughts and ideas. So when the physical factors of experience, the eyes and visible objects come in contact, and then when consciousness also becomes associated with the physical factors of experience, and visual sort of consciousness arises. So that's the five aggregates. So the five aggregates very short explained, and this is very important to understand, because what we call self or I is a combination of these aggregates. Self or I is not permanent at all, right? It's a combination of this. Because these aggregates have to come together due to karmic forces, the appearance has arisen. The aggregates are the condition that has made the appearance possible. So if you investigate these five aggregates, they become selflessness or emptiness. In order to understand selflessness, you have to understand the five aggregates, right? When you investigate, usually when we say I, what you think, what you understand, what you mean, what is the characteristic of I, without these ideas, the teachings, philosophy, these ideas, just a normal, what do you understand when you say I? What do you think? You did you ever investigate when you say I'm going to eat, I'm going to sleep, I. What you understand? What that means?
It's me.
Me, yes, I, me. What is me?
My desire.
Your what?
My desire.
Desire?
Yes. I have a desire to eat, so I am going to eat.
So your desire and your I, you say I and desires. When you say I means desire?
No, I means and the being.
The being.
Being.
You think that? Give me the characteristic of I. It's very important, right? Always we say I, me, me.
It's the essence of me.
What do you mean by essence? I'm going to, ask you very deeply.
Thoughts, feelings, perceptions?
Yep.
I would say it's the concept I have of who I am. My concept I formed of my being.
So then you are thinking about perception and thoughts and feelings.
All those aggregates are involved.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so. I think if you really investigate, I means the combination of these aggregates. People think, do you think the I is a permanent? Actually, you understand what mean by permanent? Permanent means, right, never change, ever change, right? So if you say, my hand is permanent, then my hand is always like that. If I move a little bit this, that means impermanent, right? So permanent means never ever change. Never ever change. Subtle, gross, never ever change. Permanent means like that. Sometimes people say, oh, my permanent residence. I live somewhere, my permanent resident here. That different idea. And in this case, the permanent and impermanent means, the permanent means never ever change. Well, that's also similar, right? My permanent resident means you never change other, apartment or house, right? You always stay here, never change. But that's a little bit different idea, I think. The permanent, in Buddhist point of view, the permanent means never ever change. So when you say I, if you think permanent, then never ever change. Always same. Right? So, investigate. You should investigate where is I? Investigate. It's kind of good way to investigate, because we always thinking about this, right? I'm suffering, I'm happy, I, always this. So if you really investigate, where is I?
I became very complicated all of a sudden.
Yep. Complicated, yes. If you investigate, complicated. But if you really want to practice on emptiness, you have to understand this.
But what you said is if the aggregates kind of define I, but they're always changing,
right?
Then there can't be a permanent I.
Right, exactly.
It can't be because the aggregates are always changing.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. So now, if you investigate I, then maybe you will find, okay, I means the combination of the aggregates. So now you go deep, like form. My body is a form, the aggregate. So where is my body? Where is my body? This is my body? This is my body? You have two bodies? No, I have one body. Okay, then these two. This is my body? Yes. What? It's very nice. Investigate your body. If you want to understand emptiness, you should. If you don't want lose, if you don't want lose, lose your eye. No, I'm saying you never lose. You never lose eye. You have to understand. Relatively, you never lose eye. You are working. It's perfectly, no problem. Don't worry. Ultimately, different. There are different views, different paths. Okay. So the aggregates. I think they're together. You know, then make everything. You know, good and bad and everything. So then you investigate like that, you will see the emptiness, really. You will see the emptiness. You will realize the emptiness. You understand the emptiness. Emptiness is connected with the idea of attainment of enlightenment. The idea of attainment of enlightenment is based on ignorance, right? Ignorance, which is the opposite of enlightenment. So ignorance means we all know from personal experience that what we deeply desire to gain is happiness, and what we try to avoid is suffering, right? But our actions and our behavior only lead to more suffering and not to sort of lasting joy and happiness that we sort of seek. So this is how we experience the fundamental confusion of the root of our life. That's really, you know, I think. So the emptiness is opposite to the nature situations or things as they are. Seems to be very sort of important point to work with. If you are ready to give away that basic desire, then emptiness seems to be there already. Therefore, the emptiness principle is go beyond dualistic perceptions. So the idea of emptiness depends on what is not emptiness. Understand? So this is a kind of, if you investigate selflessness, two self, selflessness of self and selflessness of phenomena, then that is emptiness. So that is the characteristic of the suffering of suffering, the truth of suffering. So that is, we are finished, the first noble truth is very briefly, okay? Now I'm going to teach you the second noble truth, the cause of suffering. The cause of suffering. The meaning of the causes of suffering, which are karma and the mental affliction, right? Everything that we experience is a result of past actions. all of our different experience of happiness and unhappiness are all a result of what we have done in the past. The Buddhist tradition teaches us that all phenomena come from cause and that everything is created based on dependent arising. And non-Buddhist tradition do not believe that things created based on dependent arising or cause and effect, dependent arising. Instead, they have, I just told you, right, 360 different views that are based in the sort of belief that things can arise spontaneously or from a creator, right? These types of thoughts leads to the sort of extremes of either nihilism and eternalism, I think. Nihilism is the belief that things arises by their own nature. And for instance, the death is the body dissolves. When we all die, you know, the body dissolves into sort of four elements, right? And consciousness disappears with the body and no longer exists, right? That's what we call in Buddhist point of view, that's nihilism. And then eternalism do not believe that past and future life and caused by, you know, the cause and effect. And they also believe that when the body sort of dissolves, the consciousness is sort of either goes up or down. They believe that, you know, sort of a God create their life and everything, and therefore the God caused their happiness and suffering. I understand that, maybe I'm wrong, but according to Buddhism, both the eternal nihilists and the nihilists are mistaken from Buddhist point of view, because based on the fact that everything that appears is empty, we cannot result in eternalism. And because everything does not appear, and everything does appear, and it is interdependent, we cannot result in nihilism. Therefore, Buddhism is the middle way, we call it middle way. All phenomena that we experience in samsara arises from cause and condition. So if you really investigate, everything is from cause and condition, then there is no way to be sort of eternalism and nihilism. It's not possible. It's logically, it doesn't make sense. If you really, of course, if you really sort of believe, you know, that everything is cause and conditions, then logically there's no way to either nihilism or the eternal. It's not good because it's logically it doesn't make sense. But if you don't believe that cause and condition, everything comes from cause and condition, then maybe yes, right? So that's the point. So it is important to think about how this experience related to cause and effect, right? If the cause is sort of positive or negative, then either happiness or suffering result. Buddhism, we believe that. We call this depends arising. So that's the key point. You have to investigate. Everything comes from cause and effect or not. That's all. If you understand, oh yes, everything is cause and effect, then there is no way, it's the three views actually. Everything is include three views: either nihilism and eternalism and middle way. These three. So if you believe and if you understand everything comes from cause and effect, then just then will be the middle way. I mean, the logically, you know, it makes sense. So I think that's very important. Very important. That's why we have different views. Buddhism has a different view than other religion because they believe that everything comes from cause and conditions. Everything is we call dependent arising. Everything depends each other. So that's why we are so different. Some other religions, they don't believe, right? They don't believe that something is create or something is spontaneously arises or something like that. That's different. That's, you know, people who believe that, that's good for them. But Buddhist point of view, the everything comes from cause and effect. Happiness, our happiness, suffering, everything comes from cause and effect. It's not. Last time I met a woman, and she's a Christian. It's very strong Christian religion, and she believed that God, and we had a very nice conversation. You know. She had a very stone, you know, she said, I just asked something, but she said, no answer. Just you have to believe. And everything comes from God. Your happiness, sufferings come from God. And then that's all. That's no more. I said, yes, okay, that's really good for you. It's very good for you. I mean, she has a faith, you know, strong belief. That's good for her. And then she said, well, this is good for everybody. No, I don't agree that. Not good for, you can't say that good for everything. I can say good for you. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Makes sense you, right? Not make sense me. Well, that seems like, you know, I'm a Buddhist, right? You can say, oh, good for you. Makes sense. I can't say Buddhism is good for everybody. No. No, that's not true. You know, it's depends who you are. So, but if you are Buddhist, then middle way is the best. But that's not good for everybody, you know. So some people like nihilism, that some people like the other, spontaneously. Oh yeah, look, see who they said that, you know. I studied long time ago. There is a school, they say, everything spontaneously arises. Who made the sun? Who made the moon? And they say that. So then I think this is just people with different views. So, but I think very important to understand everything comes from what, where. That's all. Now, second noble truth, the characteristic of the cause of suffering. That's the second. The first characteristic is cause. The second is origination. Third is intense arising. And fourth is condition. This is the second noble truth characteristics, okay? So first, the meaning of cause, for example, it's just like when a seed produces its fruit, right? So this is just like karma and affliction producing all our suffering and happiness of samsara. So that's what we call cause. And then next, the meaning of origination. can be described by the analogy of vegetable, for instance, vegetable grown from a field. Therefore, origination can be sort of described as all suffering and happiness arising from karma and afflictions. So the suffering and happiness are come from karma and afflictions, nothing other than that. That's why we need to diminish, right? That's why we have to practice, diminish our afflictions, because of that's the cause of suffering. And then third, the meaning of intense arising is described by analogy of touching a very fresh wound or injury on your body. You can't, little bit, you can't touch, it's very sensitive, right? What do you call it? Wound, right? And injury, something. It's very sensitive, like that. It's like strong karma and affliction immediately produced. And great sort of suffering. The meaning of the condition, just like a you know, the vegetable and then the farmer the requires water and what else, the fertilizer, and then it's like that. It's a suffering arises because of the condition of karma and affliction. There are also many different kind of karma and affliction, but it's necessary to understand these characteristics for that we develop the wish to avoid karma and afflictions. So that's the condition. The second noble truth has the characteristics are understand cause, right? Cause, origination, intense arising, and conditions. Okay? So now we have to meditate. When you focus on your breath, when you breathe out and breathe in, can you focus on that? Just only breathe in, breathe out? You want that, or you want more sort of visualize something else? Sort of combination of your breath and then visualize something else. I think that,
can we do something with sound?
Something with sound?
Remember when we did the same ah meditation, but we'd actually would say ah as it would go out?
Well, we can do that. It's same as the you visualize a syllable or something, a hong syllable, tip of your nose, and then when you breathe out, and the moving away from your nose, this syllable, and then getting bigger and bigger, like that, and also you say, like that, just focus on your sound and also the visualization, a syllable. Just say slowly, very gently, if you want. You want sound, meditation?
Yeah.
Okay, now we'll do that. But when you breathing in, you don't want to say, you don't want to focus on your sound, because you can't, you know, you can't. You can't just with this only focus on breathe out. Also, your breath actually, it's in this case, it comes from your mouth, right? So not your nostrils, not nostrils. Just say ah, but very gently, okay? Very gently ah. And then a little bit pause, and then start again. So you can visualize a syllable. This is the visualize a syllable, okay? And then moving away from your nose, and then getting bigger and bigger and bigger like that. And then focus on sounds, okay? We'll do that.
Do we coordinate our breath with everyone else?
No.
So it's all, so there'd be all these different ahs?
Ah. Well, we have done that, the practice, this kind of practice with sound practice a few times, but some people don't like. Some people don't like just be very, they like be very quiet. But we should try.
Awake right now.
That's right. But three to 4 o'clock, just only 1 hour meditation. No, I mean, teaching in meditation. It's very short. Everybody wake up and but you guys doing really good. It's very relaxed. And when I was the start, very beginner, and I'm not like that. It's so difficult. I just don't want, even though very difficult. It's, my body is pain, and I can't concentrate. And but I just really, you can do it. You can do it. You know, I just it's a push sort of a little bit. Myself, and now I'm very comfortable. I'm very comfortable. I can stay like this whole day, no problem. And I can focus on, you know, whatever I visualize. It's very easily. All right, are you ready? Just to relax. That's the most important. If you want, you can. Your bag is very important. Keep very straight, because then easy to breathe in, breathe out, and then your hands are just relaxed and putting your knees or whatever like this, or whatever you want. And then just relax. Maybe you can keep your eyes. You can keep your eyes closed or open, or maybe half open like that. Whatever you want. And then just relax 1 second. Ten minutes. All right. You visualize a syllable. And then when you breathe out, a little bit pause, just to relax and feel your nature, mind. Breathe in slowly. How you feel? Are you tired? No? relaxing? Ah. You understand what is different between thoughts and mind when you meditate? Not necessarily.
Thoughts are dualistic?
Dualistic. Dualistic, yes. Definitely. Means with something annoying, nature, or attachment, right? With dualistic mind, it's not free from confusion. It's not free from attachment. So when we are practicing on nature of mind, it's behind the dualistic mind. It's not really emotion mind, right? So, but that's not necessarily. For the beginners, I think it's very important to understand how to make your mind calm and peace. That's very important. If you have a peaceful mind, then you have chance to think. When you get angry, you immediately remember how to think about how to react other people. You have chance to think. It's not do something. It's immediately when people get angry without practice. You know, the not practitioner, just ordinary people get angry. They just say something immediately, or they hit, you know, immediately. There's no chance to think. That means your mind is not tame. I mean, and if you practice shamatha and you have chance to think, oh, why I get angry? What is the cause? What is the cause this angry? Can we reduce this cause or not? Then you have chance to think, right? Then you say, oh, wait a minute, I have to investigate. I have to think about what is about this. What's wrong with you? We have to think about. Just so it's very important for beginners to understand understand how to really be very calm and peace, and also important how to take care of our life. We don't need to really too much thinking about how to practice emptiness, how to practice about selflessness, because we are not there yet. These are very advanced, actually very highest practitioners thinking about and practice on. So if we are beginners, we don't need to think all these things. We are beginners, we have to understand how important other living beings in our life. We have to think about the compassion, love and kindness. These are makes us very happy. So we need really happy life. If you have a happy life, then that's just fine. That means you are happy. You are really, you have, you know, happy, and you are really sort of easy to communicate with other people. That's, I think, very important for beginners. Otherwise, sometimes very confused, these teachings, you know, sometimes they're talking about emptiness, sometimes there's nothing exists, Sometimes they think it exists. What is this? It's different people, you know, different meditators. So I think we have to focus, if you're a beginner, we have to focus on, there is an order, you know, there is a, what do you call it? First we have to focus on your mind, become a, you know, very easy to control your mind, right? And then you have to think about how to take care of your mind, how to take care of your life. That's all. Actually, the Buddhism is actually the essence of Buddha's teaching is really how to take care of our life. That's all. How to relationship with others. Your friends, your family, other people, living beings, animals, how to relationship. And mostly, you know, that's why Buddha left, you know, he, from the royal family. He asked his father, I want to go meditate. His father didn't agree. No, you can't. You have to take care of your country. He said, no, that's not how I take care of others. It's make me more suffering. It's difficult. So I have to first take care of my mind, take care of my life. First I have to take care of my life. First I have to, discipline myself in order to take care of others. Otherwise, if I'm not a good person, then I can lead other people. A good direction. I can do that. So that's why it's very important. You don't have to think too much about others. You have to think about how to take care of your life. Good way. That means actually you really understand how to take care of others too. Any questions? Sometimes I go to China and teaching about Buddhism, and they have lots of questions. lots of questions with relationship. But I think I really like to teach with Westerners because easy to understand. Because you already sort of very good educate, you know, as how to study. Most people in Asia, they don't study. They didn't go to school, you know. They don't know how to study. It's very difficult for them. All right, I think that's all for today. If you have no questions. It's already 4 o'clock, and we should stop here and make you happy and think about your life. Think about you have a precious human life. Really, you do. Precious human life. Have a good opportunity to do good things. And you should satisfy yourself. You should happy yourself. You should let go your worries, stress. You know, we don't know how long we stay in this universe, this world. We don't know how long we have. Maybe you have long life. I hope 100 years. You know, maybe we don't know. Next year I will come back here again. Maybe I will die next day. I don't know. Maybe we are together. We don't know, right? We don't know these things. But doesn't matter. You should understand. You have really good life, and you should think about how to make yourself happy. Happy is most important. Happy life, very good. Okay, now the closing prayers.